evaluations already, you would say complimentary things about your friend's work, and then all of a sudden there'd be like, what needs to change? And the person evaluating you would say something along the lines of, needs to incorporate more sensimetry. So people in your class are noticing that you're not incorporating that. And this is actually, I consider this a pretty fun activity, actually. Not necessarily annotating a poem, but the part that's coming after it, where you're going to be writing a poem of your own, you can actually use this as one of your... Why do I have American Revolution in here?
Probably because I made this a copy of the same.
Yeah, strange things stuck in here. You can use this as part of your assignment. Your multi-genre assignment. So go ahead and work on your journal for now. I'm going to give you about 5 minutes to write. If you could live during another time period, when would it be? Go ahead. You're journaling about a different time period in your life there where you may have felt like based on the music you listen to now, or clothes you wear, or things you're interested in.
I would make sure that I think the list of criteria is on Google Classroom right now.
Yes.
And you just have to look at someone else's stuff and then turn it in for the rest of your things.
Mm-hmm.
Half page, guys. So while you are listening to this poem, you can go ahead and start marking the sensory imagery and figurative language that you find within it. And then we're going to go over some of that. So that's the first part of our goal. The second part, then we're going to write a poem inspired by this work. And I like listening to her read this. Yes, her name is George, and it is a female who wrote this. I think it really adds to the poem because you get a sense of where her starts and stops are, and where they want the pauses to be. And so I like to listen to poets.
Where I'm from. I am from clothespins, from Clorox and carbon tetrachloride. I am from the dirt under the back porch, black, glistening. It tasted like beets. I am from the forsythia bush, the Dutch elm, whose long gone limbs I remember as if they were my own. I'm from fudge and eyeglasses, from Imogene and Allifair. I'm from the know-it-alls and the pass-it-ons, from perk up and pipe down. I'm from he restoreth my soul with the cotton ball lamb and 10 verses I can say myself. I'm from Artemis and Billy's branch, fried corn and strong coffee, from the finger my grandfather lost to the auger the eye my father shut to keep his sight. Under my bed was a dress box, spilling old pictures, a sift of lost faces to drift beneath my dreams. I am from those moments, snapped before I budded, leaf fall from the family tree.
You have read it differently. And that's a good comment. And I like your defense of that. The only reason I would disagree is that to me, it sounded like she was speaking a memory. And there's a couple of things in here that I want to point out to you that you're probably not ready to get on your own just from looking at it. First of all, is Imogene and Alistair. This woman, George L. Lyon, is from Kentucky. And Imogene and Alistair were two old ladies who lived on her street. Yes, Cody.
I wanted to make a comment about what they said.
Go ahead. I didn't see you. I apologize. Imogene and Alistair were people who lived on her street. They were two old women who, she just really liked their names, but she remembered that they were always sort of the ladies in the know who knew what was happening in her neighborhood all the time. Gossips, yes. And Artemis and Billy's Branch are both places in Kentucky. Artemis, I believe, is a town, and Billy's Branch is part of a river system. So let's just look at the first sentence together. Clothespins, Clorox, and carbon tetrachloride. What do we notice from that first, Melissa? Look at the sounds. And what is that example of? Who can help her out? Go ahead, AJ.
She did a lot of laundry.
Think about this. We're still talking about the sounds, though. Remember what that's an example of? It's alliteration. Thank you very much. Why do you think she used Clorox instead of just saying bleach? What's that?
It has a C.
Sure, so she wanted to stick with the alliteration. What else? But Melissa, what did you say? Okay. Think about what... My mother always used Tide laundry detergent, not the ones that you eat, but the containers. And if you go in a grocery store and you see Tide, what color bottle is it in? Do you know?
Orange.
It's an orange bottle, and you can always pretty much pick that out. Clorox is the same. Clorox has a certain symbol, and so maybe... She was doing that for not necessarily a sense, like a smell, but what else could it be? Imagery, like what kind of imagery? What the logo looks like, so there's a visual element there. Does anyone know what carbon tetrachloride is? Any chemists in here? He says white and clothes, what else? Because we were talking about cleaning clothes before. It's also something that's used in dry cleaning. And so if you've ever picked up clothes from a dry cleaner, it's got a specific kind of stink to it. And so I'm wondering if she linked those together because it's all like not only were there visual elements, but kind of a smell associated with doing laundry. So just in that one sentence, we found alliteration, we've seen visual elements, we've seen smells. So I'm going to let you go ahead and work, talk amongst yourselves. Smells, smell imagery, stink. Go ahead and talk to the people among you, and you guys can just go through this poem, okay? Again, I'm only going to give you about 5 minutes, okay? Don't delve deep into meaning. We're just looking for those elements of figurative language and sensory imagery.
I think it does.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it is.
You can move your chairs if you need to.
I'm sorry.
So how does this that's sort of something that you'd hear when you're in kids. And he would shout out the word listen, which got us to stop talking. And so this is different. He said that.
Now you've learned.
So now sure. I get that.
Okay, let's just go on a few. What else did you find in here?
What haven't you been told, Ben Tom?
Yeah, what he said.
I don't know what he just said.
I do.
So what do you have to add? What would you like to add? What would you like to share with us? Yes. You know what? I question that too, because I'm wondering if he has to shut his eye. No. I think those are two separate things. Go ahead. That's what I thought too. Why do you shut one eye? Because you're shooting at something.
You should be able to shoot.
So you keep your sight.
Maybe you've got something in your eye.
You keep something in your sight? They're not killing. I don't think they're killing me. I think there was a lot of augers. Okay, so what else did you find?
Oh my god.
Her grandfather lost the finger of the auger.
Yep, grandpa lost something in a finger of the auger.
Yeah.
Anybody experienced that before? No one who's lost? Know anybody who's lost something? Tell me more. Ooh, like rodeo?
Yeah.
Your computer's black.
That's all right. Still going. So, what about the fudge? What kind of sense is that?
Casey.
Very good. What about perk up and pipe down?
She's a perk up.
One person at a time. So they're religious. That's good. How do you get that? Where do you see that? He restoreth my soul. Where is that from? It's from the 23rd Psalm. Yes. What kind of sense do you get from that cotton ball lamb?
Touch.
You're touching something, yes. So you see with just about every word and every sentence she writes here, she's thrown in something that is a bit of a sense. Like you can taste fudge. You can hear somebody saying, pipe down. At least.
Pipe down.
And so, perk up, pipe down. Those are things that people say to you in your life. And so I wanted to point out to you that this is not complicated language she uses here. Sensory imagery doesn't have to be elaborate or flowery. It can be just very simplistic, but it paints a picture for you of what kind of life she was living. So I want you, if the people in the front could pass out that next brainstorm sheet. On one side I have written It's called Murray's Examples on this side. And I did this in about 3 minutes. Thinking
what?
About things to fill this in. Really? Where do we need more? Thank you, Will. Did you get this? So you're going to go through, excuse me, thank you. You're going to go through and you're going to fill in those boxes on the front, just like I've done for you as an example. And then when you are done with that, yes sir? This one? Yep. then you're going to write your own Where I'm From poem. And you can go line by line if you want to. And you will be turning this in today along with your brainstorming sheet. Okay? If you need help, I'm right here. You can work with people on the brainstorming, but you have to write the poem on your own. Draw a picture. What kind of music you listen to? I've heard you talk about Johnny Cash before.
That's so great.
You like rap? This is about you. If you want to write your poem on the back, excuse me. If you would like to write your poem on the back of the poem that I gave you, that's fine. We'll save a tree.
Like people in your life that have given to influence you, people that represent.
As soon as you think you've got enough brainstorming done, go ahead and start working on your poem. Last thing I want to tell you is that at the bottom here, I've included some links for how to create a storyboard, how to write epitaphs, which go on gravestones, how to write a toast, how to write an obituary, how to write a witness statement. If there is something specific that you want to write for your third genre and you don't know how to do it, ask me.
My dad was like smoking and talking.
That is terrible.
It's a very short poem.
Yeah. It'll stay.
Just put it right here.
Yeah, because I did it to do this. That counts as a class. I did the narrative, three poems. I can do a couple of them.
Okay, so you've got about 15 minutes left in the class period. You can continue working on this, or you can start working on the rest of your assignment for the rest of the week. If you have any questions regarding that third genre, you have to ask, okay? And it might not help you to ask Mrs. Bell, because she might not know. She might not. Turn in your poem, turn in your brainstorm sheet.
Anything before the age of seven.